हेलो एवरीवन, आई एम आर्किटेक्ट योगेश यादव फ्रॉम APJ स्कूल ऑफ आर्किटेक्चर एंड प्लानिंग। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस न्यूयॉर्क 5 एज द सेकंड पार्ट ऑफ मॉड्यूल 6 ऑफ RAR 607, दैट इज हिस्ट्री ऑफ आर्किटेक्चर 5। दीज आर द कंटेंट्स विच we will cover in this lecture. First of all, we will understand about the New York Five, its introduction. Then we will discuss in detail about the introduction philosophies and works of all five architects of the New York Five group. Now let me introduce you. What is this New York 5? Actually, the New York 5 is a group of 5 New York City based architects, and their names are architect Peter Eisenman, Michael Graves, Charles Guatme, John Heder and Richard Meyer. There was a conference of architects for the study of environment. It is also called as CASE group, and this conference was held at the Museum of Modern Art, and which was organized by the director of the museum, Arthur Drexler, and the historian, architectural historian, Colin Rowe, in 1969. Arthur Drexler, the director of Museum of Modern Art, he invited a group of architects to present their recent built projects to a panel of critics. So the purpose of this gathering at the Museum of Modern Art was to exhibit and criticize the work of five architects about which we are talking: Eisenman, Graves, Guatme, Heder, and architect Richard Meyer. And they also constituted a New York school. So the common thing between these five architects was that they were working on a pure form of architectural modernism, which was a recall to the work of Le Corbusier, jo ki 1920s or 30s mein hua tha. Although if we look into the work closely, it was far more individual, and this grouping maybe because of the social and academic connections, and particularly the mentoring role of architect Philip Johnson. Here you can see the photographs of all five architects which came to be known as New York Five, and their work was presented in Museum of Modern Art, about which we were talking, which was organized by Arthur Drexler and architectural historian Colin Rowe. I will tell you one more thing here, that this group was also referred as whites, because the white describes frequent use of white paint in the built work of these New York Five architects, as well as the white cardboard models they frequently presented. And this also alludes and suggests to the group's affinity with work of Le Corbusier, such as the white exterior surfaces of Villa Savoy, and this affinity would later be used by many critics and to suggest that the work of New York Five was excessively uncritical of modernism, and that their work was an unimaginative copy of Le Corbusier's work. Now we will discuss in detail about architect Peter Eisenman. Peter Eisenman was born in August in 1932. He was an American architect, and he is considered as one of the New York Five. He is well known for his writing and speaking about architecture, as well as his designs. His designs have been called as the high modernist or deconstructive. आर्किटेक्ट पीटर आइजनमैन इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट कॉन्ट्रोवर्सियल प्रोटेगोनिस्ट ऑफ द आर्किटेक्चरल सीन हु इज नोन एज मच फॉर हिज थ्योरेटिकल एसेज एज ही इज फॉर हिज आर्किटेक्चर. सो वाइल मच हैज बीन रिटन अबाउट हिज बिल्ट वर्क्स एंड हिज फिलोसफीज, स्टीफेनो कॉर्वो हैज रिटन ऑन हिज फिलोसफी दैट इज फ्रॉम फॉर्मलिज्म टू वीक फॉर्म. द आर्किटेक्चर एंड फिलोसफी ऑफ पीटर आइजनमैन आर्ग्यूज दैट फॉर्म इज द स्फीयर ऑफ मीडिएशन बिटवीन आर बॉडी, आर इनर वर्ल्ड एंड द एक्सटीरियर वर्ल्ड एंड एज सच इट इनेबल्स द कनेक्शंस टू बी मेड बिटवीन फिलोसफी एंड आर्किटेक्चर एंड थ्रू दिस फ्रॉम फॉर्मलिज्म टू वीक फॉर्म. स्टीफेनो कॉर्वो लिंक्स टूगेदर द आइजनमैन्स आर्किटेक्चर विद हिज थ्योरी. वी सी इन हिज वर्क्स दैट ही रिजेक्टेड द फंक्शनल कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ मॉडर्निज्म. ही डिजाइंड मैनी एलिमेंट्स लाइक, ऐसा लगेगा आपको कि कॉलम है लेकिन वो कॉलम का काम नहीं कर रहा है, बीम है लेकिन वो बीम का काम नहीं कर रही है. सो हिज वर्क्स वर करेक्टराइज्ड बाई डिसकंसर्टिंग द फॉर्म्स, एंगल्स एंड मटीरियल्स. अकॉर्डिंग टू द पीटर आइजनमैन ही सेज दैट व्हेन यू कैन सेंस द इनकम्प्लीटनेस ऑफ अ फिनिश्ड स्ट्रक्चर इट इज़ अ पैराडॉक्सिकल एक्सपीरियंस. And he says that if the parts that make up a whole are in conflict, then the sensation of incomplete contests the fact that the structure is a finished and fully enclosed space. Peter Eisenman has always sought somewhat obscure, means not known, or we can say unclear parallels between his architectural works and the philosophical or literary theories. His earlier works generated from the transformation of forms related to the tenuous or weak relationship of language to an underlying structure. The later works of Peter Eisenman reflects the ideas of deconstructivism. We will see in examples. He always tries to unlink the function that architecture may represent from the appearance form of that same architectural object. Here, these are some important works of architect Peter Eisenman, like House 6, designed in 1972, Wexner Center for the Arts, designed in 1989, Nurutani Building in 1991, Greater Columbus Convention Center, designed in 1993, Arnoff Center for Design and Art in 1996, City of Culture of Galicia, designed in 1999, Memorial to the Murdered Jews of Europe, designed in 2005, and the University of Phoenix Stadium in 2006. Now we will try to understand the design philosophies of Peter Eisenman through his works. So this is House 6, one of the significant building designed by him and completed in 1975. Through these given drawings here, we can see that the Peter Eisenman created a form from the intersection of the four planes, and by manipulating the structures again and again until the spaces begin to emerge as the coherent spaces. The envelope and the structure of the building, they are just a manifestation of the changed elements of the original four slabs with some limited modifications.
He says that the purely conceptual design meant that the architecture is strictly plastic, bearing no relationship to the construction techniques of purely ornamental form. Architect Peter Eisenman, in his earlier stage of career, he designed a series of houses named as House 1 to House 10, and from them, his House 2, 6, and 10, they are the most famous projects of his initial ones. He designed this house for Mr. and Mrs. Richard Frank in 1972 to 75. The client found great admiration for the Eisenman's work. Till then, Eisenman was known as the paper architect and the theorist, so they gave him chance to put his theories to practice. This house is situated on a flat site in Cornwall. House 6 stands its own ground as a sculpture in its surroundings, and the design of this house emerged from a conceptual process that began with the grid. Peter Eisenman manipulated the grid in such a way so that the house was divided into the four sections. Therefore, structural elements were revealed so that the construction process was evident but not always understood. So it creates a confusion kind of thing. So does the house become a study between the actual structure and the architectural theory? The house was efficiently constructed using a simple post and beam system. And if we see the house, some columns or beams play no structural role, and they are incorporated just to enhance the conceptual design. Like there is one column in the kitchen which hovers over the kitchen table, not even touching the ground. So in the other spaces, we will see that beams meet but do not intersect, and they are creating a cluster of the supports. So here, these are the drawings of the house. At the ground floor, it is having the living room and the kitchen area, dining area, whereas at the first floor, there is bedroom and the other spaces. Here we can see the vertical details of the building and the artificial excavation done to reflect the structure as the sculpture in the site. So here, these are the all four sides elevations: the south side elevation, east elevation, north elevation, and the west elevation, showing how the Peter Eisenman created this form from the intersection of the four planes, manipulating the structure again and again. So it resulted in this kind of elevations. This is the axonometric view showing the complete structure and the four planes and their intersection. The working style of architect Peter Eisenman was to play with the intersection of grids. So this structure was incorporated into the Eisenman's grid to convey the module that created the interior spaces with a series of planes that slipped through each other. As here we can see in these two images, and it was purposely ignoring the idea of modernism, that is form following function. Eisenman created the spaces that were quirky and well lit, means creating the surprise, but rather than unconventional to live with. Eisenman made it difficult for the users सो दैट दे हैव टू ग्रो अकस्टम टू द आर्किटेक्चर, मतलब लोगों को रहने के लिए उनको आदत डालनी पड़ेगी, जो एक्चुअल में उसका मानना ये था पीटर आइजनमैन का कि द आर्किटेक्चर वी रिमेम्बर इज दैट विच नेवर कंसोल्स और कंफर्ट अस, जो जिसमें हम आराम से रह सकें वो हमें याद नहीं रहता, हमें वही याद रहता है जहाँ पे हम मतलब नॉर्मल ना लगे, कुछ अलग हो. सो फॉर इंस्टेंस वी कैन सी हियर इन द बेडरूम देयर इज़ अ ग्लास स्लॉट इन द सेंटर ऑफ द वॉल कंटिन्यूइंग थ्रू द फ्लोर दैट डिवाइड्स द रूम इन हाफ एंड इट इज़ फोर्सिंग देयर टू सेपरेट द बेड्स ऑन आइदर साइड ऑफ द रूम. वन ऑफ द अनदर क्यूरियस आस्पेक्ट इन दिस डिज़ाइन इज़ एन अपसाइड डाउन स्टेयरकेस, मीन्स द एलिमेंट विच पोर्ट्रेज द एक्सिस ऑफ द हाउस एंड इट इज़ पेंटेड इन रेड कलर टू ड्रॉ द अटेंशन. देयर आर द अदर डिफिकल्ट आस्पेक्ट्स ऑल्सो दैट डिसरप्ट कन्वेंशनल लिविंग, लाइक द कॉलम हैंगिंग ओवर द डाइनिंग टेबल दैट सेपरेट्स द डाइनर्स एंड द सिंगल बाथरूम दैट इज ओनली एसेसिबल थ्रू अ बेडरूम. सो आइसनमैन वॉज एबल टू कॉन्स्टेंटली रिमाइंड इट्स यूजर्स अबाउट द आर्किटेक्चर अराउंड देम एंड हाउ इट अफेक्ट्स देयर लाइफ. सो एज अनोइंग एज द हाउस वॉज टू इनहेबिट, आइसनमैन वॉज एबल टू constantly remind the users of the architecture around them and how it affects their lives. So in this way he succeeded in building a structure that is functioning both as a house and a work of art, but here changing the priority of both so that the function followed the art. In this way he built a home where man was forced to live in a work of art or a we can say a sculpture. According to the client who enjoyed inhabiting this artwork and poetry created by Eisenman, so we can say the house was successful. This is the Wexner Center, the another project of architect Peter Eisenman. This center is in Ohio State University and it is a multidisciplinary international laboratory for the explanation and advancement of contemporary art. This Wexner Center opened in November 1989 and it was named in honor of the father of Limited Brands founder Leslie Wexner. So to design this Wexner Center, architect Peter Eisenman and Richard Trott, they won the design competition, and Eisenman impressed the jury with his bold ideas for the art center, which were aimed at linking the past to the present through the use of unconventional means. And this was the first major public building to be designed by Eisenman, and he previously was known primarily as a teacher and theorist. So based on the controversial theory that art should be challenged by its environment rather than displayed neutrally, this museum raised Eisenman's profile, and after that he went on to design and build a number of other major projects. So this was the first large public commission, and we can say the first large scale construction of the deconstructivist architecture. So as the design process, Eisenman identified two adjacent grids and then composed them on top of one another, then subdivide the grid to appropriate scales, after that identifying the pathways, event sites, stresses, views and the other potential connections, and finally organized the program circulation and building elements to correspond to the pathway connections, stresses, views, and the potential connections. So in this way, to design this vectional center, Eisenman used an extensive method of giving the architecture its own voice by using the rotated grid. And Eisenman grafted one grid on top of the other, seeking the potential connections at urban, local, and the interior scales. As a means of mediating the scale of the urban grid towards a pedestrian or human scale, the scalar operations are performed. And the results of these operations, they serve as a map that is used to locate program pathways, structure, interior forms, excavations, and views along the newly afforded possibilities, both in the horizontal and the vertical planes. And in almost every aspect of the construction of this design, the results of these operations are visible. So to add the depth of possibilities afforded by this excavation of immediate condition of the grid, architect grafted the figured scaffolding onto the site and integrating this figure into primary circuit or pathway of the building. So this scaffolding is scaled to represent the module of the grid that is interpretable at a human scale, and the scaffold is reduced to its raw type, to the essential condition, which signifies the essence of its existence, that being an impermanent accessory to the architecture that allows its construction but does not necessarily the shelter. So this architecture of non-shelter is aligned directly adjacent to an interior pathway within the building that does not enclose and protect. So we have seen in the photograph also, the design includes a large white metal grid and which mean to suggest the scaffolding to give the building a sense of incompleteness in tune with the architect's deconstructivist taste or idea. Eisenman also took note of this mismatched street grids of the Ohio State University campus and the city of Columbus, which vary by 12.25 degrees, and designed this Wexner Center to alternate which the grid it followed. So the result was a building of sometimes questionable functionality, but it admitted the architectural interest. Wexner Center को डिजाइन करने में पीटर आइसेनमैन का ये आइडिया था कि वो कैसे पास्ट को प्रेजेंट के साथ में लिंक कर सकते हैं. एंड फॉर दैट व्हाट ही डिड, ही कपल्ड हिज ग्रिड एब्स्ट्रैक्शंस विद अ सीरीज ऑफ फिगर्स, एंड आउट ऑफ दैट मोस्ट प्रोमिनेंट वाज अ रिकंस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ अ पार्ट ऑफ आर्मरी दैट ऑक्यूपाइड दिस पर्टिकुलर साइट फ्रॉम 1898 एंड टिल इट वाज टर्मिनली डैमेज्ड बाय फायर इन 1958. सो आइसेनमैन has presented the figure of the armory along the south pedestrian axis, which is the most visually accessible elevation of this building, and it has been reduced to a series of fragments of armory like forms, which is indicating the essence of the armory without reproducing any of the original intricate detail. As we can see in the photograph of the building, there is the fragmented bastion kind of structure. So this was the method he followed. He reduced the form to its essential components and then fragmented the elevations by cutting away pieces and replacing them with an inert material as per the condition, and selected the fragments of the armory that fall outside of the scope of built form, and using the foundation as a ट्रेस साइट एलिमेंट. फोटोग्राफ्स के थ्रू समझने की कोशिश करेंगे कि विद इन द आर्मरी फॉर्म्स जो क्रिएट की हैं उनमें द नेगेटिव स्पेस कार्व्ड आउट ऑफ द सॉलिड ब्रिक मासेस दैट इज मेकिंग अप दीज फिगर्स इन कास्ट विद अ डार्क टिंटेड कर्टेन वॉल एंड विद इन विच इज एन अल्यूमिनियम मलियन पैटर्न. यू कैन सी इन द सेकेंड फोटोग्राफ इट इज क्लियरली विजिबल एंड विच इज एवोकेटिव ऑफ द यूज ऑफ ग्रिड. ग्रिड बन रही है एल्यूमिनियम मुलियंस की एंड द कंट्रास्ट क्रिएटेड बाई दीज एनोडाइज एल्यूमिनियम ऑफ द मुलियंस इट इंटेंसीफाइज द इम्पेनिट्रेबल डेप्थ ऑफ द ग्लास. सो द लैक ऑफ हिस्टोरिकल फाइडलिटी और द एग्जैक्टनेस इन द रिकन्स्ट्रक्शन ऑफ द आर्मरी डिज़ाइन द फ्रेगमेंटेशन ऑफ द फॉर्म एंड देन द इंसर्शन ऑफ डार्क ग्लास इन टू द वॉइड्स लेफ्ट बिटवीन दीज फ्रेगमेंट्स सीम्स टू स्पीक ऑफ द डिसजॉइंटेड मैनर इन विच वी रिफ्लेक्ट द पास्ट एंड इन टर्न इट सर्व्स टू रिमाइंड अस ऑफ द पास्ट वी हैव लॉस्ट दैट इट कैन नेवर रिटर्न टू. तो पीटर आइसेनमैन ने इसके थ्रू ये मैसेज कन्वे करने की कोशिश की है कि जो पास्ट निकल गया इट विल नेवर रिटर्न. नाउ वी विल लुक इनटू द ड्राइंग्स ऑफ दिस वैक्सनर सेंटर. सो दिस इज द साइट प्लान एंड दिस वैक्सनर सेंटर इंक्लूड्स अ फिल्म एंड वीडियो थिएटर, अ परफॉर्मेंस स्पेस, देर इज़ अ फिल्म एंड वीडियो पोस्ट प्रोडक्शन स्टूडियो, अ कैफे, बुक स्टोर एंड द गैलरीज. हियर इन दीज ड्राॅइंग्स वी कैन सी द वेरियस डिटेल्स एट डिफरेंट लेवल्स और द वर्टिकल डिटेल्स ऑफ द बिल्डिंग. दीज आर द साइट एलिवेशंस शोइंग द साइट प्रोफाइल ऑफ द वैक्सनर सेंटर एंड दिस वैक्सनर सेंटर इज इन 10,000 स्क्वायर मीटर एरिया विथ थ्री स्टोरीड बिल्डिंग. दिस इज द 3D व्यू ऑफ द वैक्सनर सेंटर क्लियरली शोइंग इट्स वेरियस बिल्डिंग कंपोनेंट्स एंड हाउ द साइट वॉज डिवाइडेड यूजिंग द ग्रिड एब्स्ट्रैक्शंस. एट द साउथ एक्सिस पॉइंट इट इज शोइंग द आर्मरी फॉर्म्स लाइक द टरेट्स. नाउ डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द अनदर आर्किटेक्ट ऑफ द ग्रुप न्यूयॉर्क 5, हियर वी विल डिस्कस माइकल ग्रेव्स. आर्किटेक्ट माइकल ग्रेव्स वॉज बॉर्न इन 1934 इन इंडियानापोलिस इन USA. He was also an American architect and he received the architectural training at University of Cincinnati and Harvard University. He won the Rome Prize in 1960 and studied for 2 years at the American Academy in Rome. He began his own practice in 1964 with the firm name as Michael Graves and Associate. Michael Graves was the postmodern leader and he continues to turn to architecture itself for his inspiration. Michael Graves was very much interested in reinterpreting the forms and compositions of the existing architecture like the ancient and neoclassical and the others. Uska ek siddhant tha Michael Graves ka ki there is no such thing as an original idea. But everything original is based on the reworking of already exist. और माइकल ग्रेव्स के वर्क्स पे बहुत स्ट्रॉन्ग इन्फ्लुएंस देखने को मिलता है. उसका एक तो इंटरेस्ट इस चीज़ में और अप्रिसिएट करना टू द सिंपल डोमेस्टिक रिचुअल्स ऑफ लाइफ दैट वन एन्जॉयज डिस्पाइट ऑफ the speed at which technology is rustling us into the cyber space. Michael Graves की philosophy ये रही है कि the architectural language should be legible and it should be a part of everyday life. And he was very much interested in reworking the commonly accepted language of architecture into a uniquely personal expression of what it might become. विदाउट लूजिंग इट्स आइडेंटिटी, बिना पहचान खोए कैसे उसमें क्या कुछ आप एक्सप्रेस कर सकते हो बाई रीवर्किंग द आइडियाज़. सो द रीवर्किंग ऑफ वॉट एग्जिस्ट इन टू वॉट इज़ अननोन but still recognizable. So this is the goal of architect Michael Graves, and he is constantly practicing the rules and principles of architecture. Aim of Michael Graves is to create a pleasant and comfortable environment for the people in his building designs. जैसा कि माइकल ग्रेव्स की डिज़ाइन फिलोसफी रही है टू रीवर्क द ऑलरेडी एग्जिस्टिंग आर्किटेक्चरल आइडियाज, सो ही इज कंटिन्यूसली इवॉल्विंग द एक्सपेरिमेंटेशन विद द आर्किटेक्चरल फॉर्म एंड लैंग्वेज एट द लेवल ऑफ एब्स्ट्रैक्शन एंड फिगरेशन, स्केल एंड कलर, साइज एंड द स्ट्रक्चरल सिस्टम्स इन सच अ वे दैट there is the emergence of the new ideas without denying the existence of traditions. Michael Graves के लिए formal manipulation करके एक अपने लिए self referential language बनाना इतना important नहीं रहा, but for him it was equally important to see the building's significance with time and place. उसका मानना ये रहा है कि द नॉन आर्किटेक्ट्स कैन रिकॉग्नाइज डिस्टिंक्ट आर्किटेक्चरल एलिमेंट्स विद इन देयर कंपोजिशंस एंड दे कैन रिलेट देम इन स्केल टू देयर ओन बॉडीज. अगर हम उसके स्टार्टिंग के प्रोजेक्ट्स को देखें तो हिज अर्ली प्रोजेक्ट्स रिवील्स द डिस्टिंक्ट रेफरेंसेस टू द एनवायरमेंट, जैसे कि अ कर्व रेफरिंग टू द क्लाउड्स अबव, अ येलो रेल referring to the sun, and the terracotta base, it is suggesting the grounding in the earth, and the mural expanding the perspective of a room. It has been the design strategy of Michael Graves to internalize the events of the building by identifying the particular components of the design program which can be given formal emphasis or can be highlighted, and the result was these large complexes become cities into themselves and self-contained by somewhat inward looking. So whether the emphasis of the building is primarily horizontal or it is vertical, a hierarchical route is established through the repetitive spaces, and there is the relationship between the indoors and outdoors by taking out the wall as far out as it can get to make a bay window that can grab the light, for example in the Humana building, or by carving something out of the face of the building so that people can literally go outside, for example in the Tazima building. Michael Graves was influenced by the Roman style as he was very much interested in reworking the existing design languages. So he tried to create grand interior spaces but broken down to human scale. Cubical facades treated in the classical three-part division or the tripartite form with base, shaft and cornice. And in the later projects of Michael Graves, the stripped form of the cube is broken. So here, this is the Thomson Consumer Electronics America's headquarters, designed in 1994 in Indianapolis in United States. Here, the influence of the Roman style can be seen. As the architectural details, in Michael Graves buildings, windows acts like the basic element as surface texture due to their proportion and repetition. As here we can see in all three buildings, see the windows, how they are acting like the basic element for surface texture because of their repetition and the proportion. Now we will discuss one of the important work of architect Michael Graves. So this is the Maritime Experiential Museum designed by him. This museum draws its inspiration from the sea-going vessels एंड दिस इज एन आइकॉनिक स्ट्रक्चर विच एम्बडीज द स्टोरीज एंड कंटेंट द एग्जिबिट्स एंड प्रोग्राम्स विच आर प्रेजेंटेड इन साइड एंड थ्रू आउट द डे द शेडोज एंड अ डेपल्ड लाइट विच इज कास्टेड बाई द रिब्ड फ्रेम एबव इट एनलाइवन द इंटीरियर एग्जिबिट्स. It provides a wide variety of experiences for the visitors by having the interactive exhibits and the circular 300-seat Typhoon Theater. This museum is having the exhibit which focuses on the maritime silk route, which historically stretched from the Southeast Asia to Oman, of which the Singapore geographically was an important part of this history. This museum is set back from the water's edge by an esplanade with a covered pedestrian loggia, which allows the visitors to enjoy the view of the mainland across the bay. And during the night, when it is viewed from the water, the glass facade of the museum will reveal the brightly lit interior, and that is becoming a beacon on the water and as a landmark on the horizon. And on the west of the museum, there is a small marina displaying examples of sailing vessels and acting as a tourist attraction in its own right, and which lends an air of authenticity to the museum complex. So this is the image here of covered pedestrian loggia that allows the visitors to enjoy the view of mainland across the bay. And the museum and marina, they are thematically linked to the adjacent outdoor marine life park, and they form a rich tourist experience focused on the sea, marine life and maritime experiences. And along the waterfront at the base of Universal Plaza, there is the Showplace Theater with large stone steps creating a seating area for 2000 people, and with views across the bay to main island. This is the location of the dance crane and a nightly sound and a light show in water that epitomizes, or I will say, the perfect example of fun and drama of resorts world. Here this is the plan of the museum showing the Typhoon Theater and the other various parts. So this is the another building designed by architect Michael Graves. This is the Denver Central Library, designed in Denver, Colorado, which was started in 1990 and was completed in 1996. The total floor area is 133,000 square feet, and it comprises the renovation and the new construction also. The structure system is used as the structural concrete waffle slabs on concrete columns. The material used is the cast stone, natural stone, timber is used, and there is the copper roofing. Michael Graves was commissioned in 1990 to renovate and design an extension to the Denver Central Library. So this library is adjacent to the Denver Art Museum, and it stands as the 8th largest library in the United States. The area of 405,000 square feet in addition to the existing library allows for the original building designed in 1956 to maintain its own identity. So in this way, it is having the addition and the original library. They are two parts in a larger composition. So with these two parts are connected by a three-story atrium, and this atrium is serving as the new main entrance that is the main focal point for the visitor orientation and as well as for the circulation to either wing of the library. Michael Graves has worked in such a way so that the scale and coloration of the addition, as well as the individualized massing of its various components, allow the original library
to maintain its own identity as one element of larger composition. So there are the two major public entrances, establish an east-west access through the Great Hall, a three-story public room of urban scale, which is the focal point for the visitor orientation and circulation, and the south-facing rotunda contains special such as the reference room, the periodicals center, and on the top floor there is the Western History reading room. So if we talk about the decorative aesthetics, the interior of the library is fairly conservative as for a postmodern building, and most of the spaces appear as traditional library spaces composed of natural wood, evoking a sense of grandeur and excessiveness, and only in the reading rooms there is any trace of the postmodern aesthetic. One begins to understand the abstracted colonnades and the vaulting and colorful painting. So in this way, Michael Grabe is creating more of a fun learning environment rather than a stark and serious library space. So this library, maybe it is one of the first library to function more than just a library. In addition to the extensive literary collections, this functions as a community gathering space consisting of multi-purpose rooms, meeting facilities, shops, a cafe, and there is a special museum-like collection. So the Denver Central Library in downtown Denver is acting as a large cultural epicenter, not only as an academic institution. Now we will see the drawings of the Denver Central Library. So here, this is the site plan and the ground floor plan of the Denver Central Library. On the ground floor plan, we can see the layout having lobby, great hall, the circulation spaces, reference entry hall, and the reference reading room, workroom. There is the children library, children pavilion, and the popular library reading rooms of the Central Library, then stair hall and the library store. Here we can see the vertical details of the building at various levels and can correlate what we have seen in the photographs in the previous slides. And here this is the front main elevation of the building, showing the main characteristics of the building and the design approach of Michael Graves. Now we will discuss about Charles Guatme, another architect of New York Five Group. Charles Guatme was also an American architect. He was born in 1938 and died in 2009. Guatme was celebrated for his geometric inspired modernist architecture, and in his earlier career, Guatme gained prominence as the youngest of five New York city based architects about which we are talking. And he was influenced by the modernist ideals of architect Le Corbusier. Charles Guatme studied architecture at the University of Pennsylvania and Yale University. His works are characterized by the bold geometric shapes wound seamlessly and togetherly unapologetically. He founded his own firm in 1968 with his fellow architect Robert Sisel, and his firm was noted for bridging the divide between small and large projects, creating a massive public buildings, mainly the museums, as well as he designed the private homes for the exclusive clients. His firm's designs were occasionally controversial. A notable example of this was the initial plan for the renovation and expansion of Solomon R. Guggenheim Museum, which was originally designed by Frank Lloyd Wright, and
Guatme also taught architecture at the various universities, including the Harvard, Princeton, and Yale University. Now we will discuss the work of architect Charles Guatme in detail. So this is Guatme's own residence and a studio. This residence was designed in 1680 square feet area, and it was completed in 1967. It was designed by architect Charles Guatme for his own parents. The house was located on a flat site on Eastern Long Island in New York near the ocean, and it was surrounded by undeveloped land. So this land was planned to be used for an addition to the house later on. As his first residential project, Guatme was given the freedom by his parents to have full control of the design. So he was set free to design and explore his ideas. He intended to design this house as a sculpture on the site, and for this he approached by carving out the primitive forms like the cubes to create different spaces. Carving of these spaces was determined by responses to the site, solar orientation, the design program, and the structure. The intended spaces for the original 1200 square feet house were a living and a dining space, kitchen, master bedroom, and the studio, two guest bedrooms, and a workroom. So here this is the view of the house. The design was approached in such a way that it created a vertical scheme and organization of the spaces, and dividing it into the three distinct levels: the base, which is the location of the workroom, the covered terrace and guest rooms, the habitable level, which contained the living room, dining room, and the kitchen, and the third level was, which is also the most private space, with the master bedroom and the studio that are pushed back with a balcony overlooking the double height living room. So by making the second level the more public rooms, Guatme established a new relationship between the public space and the ground level, and in this way creating a situation unique from the conventional residential projects. After 1 year from the completion of this house, an addition was constructed with a new studio and guest room, and this new addition is a complete separate building, as here we can see in the first image, and it involved the same idea of carving out the spaces from a geometric form that was a sculptural on the land, as like the original house. And the new studio and guest room have the presence of a movable object as opposed to the original house, which seems embedded into the ground. This addition is also placed at 45 degree angle to the original building, thereby creating a corner versus facade condition that is dynamic in itself and with the site also. The wooden frame construction covered with the cedar siding for the interiors and exteriors also was used for both residence and the studio, and some windows are placed solely with the cedar siding itself, while the others have the frames painted in red, yellow, or black. And they have been thought by inspiring from the Le Corbusier's houses, especially the noticeable on the exterior with curved staircase in an otherwise rectilinear scheme. Charles Guatme's Long Island residence and studio, they emphasize the three-dimensional objects through the volumetric interpenetration of the solids and the materials like glass and wood to create the functional voids. Now we will discuss his another important work of द रिनोवेशन एंड एडिशन इन सोलोमन आग अगेनियम म्यूजियम इन न्यूयॉर्क. सो दिस इज़ द की इंफॉर्मेशन अबाउट दिस प्रोजेक्ट. लाइक इट वॉज हैविंग द एरिया ऑफ 51,000 स्क्वायर फीट ऑफ न्यू एंड रिनोवेटेड गैलरी स्पेस. न्यू आउटडोर स्कल्पचर गार्डन इज देयर. देर इज़ द रिस्टोर्ड थिएटर, न्यू म्यूजियम शॉप, न्यू रेस्टोरेंट, 15,000 स्क्वायर फीट ऑफ द न्यू ऑफिस स्पेस एंड द मॉडर्न एडिशन टू एन हिस्टोरिक कॉन्टेक्स्ट. रेस्टोरेशन ऑफ द ओरिजिनल स्काईलाइट्स, रेस्टोरेशन एंड कन्वर्जन ऑफ द एरियाज फॉर्मरली इनएक्सेसिबल टू द पब्लिक, सो दे वर मेड एक्सेसिबल. लोडिंग डॉक, सर्विस एंट्री एंड द एलिवेटर. दिस प्रोजेक्ट वॉज कम्प्लीटेड इन 1992. सो दिस रिनोवेशन प्रोजेक्ट ऑफ आर्किटेक्ट चार्ल्स ग्वात्मे एंड रॉबर्ट सीजल इन द न्यूयॉर्क सिटी इज वन ऑफ द फर्म्स मोस्ट सेलिब्रेटेड एंड क्रिटिकली एक्लेम्ड वर्क्स एंड इट कंटेन्स द एरिया 51,000 स्क्वायर फीट ऑफ न्यू एंड रिनोवेटेड गैलरी स्पेस, 15,000 स्क्वायर फीट ऑफ द न्यू ऑफिस स्पेस, अ रिस्टोर्ड थिएटर, न्यू रेस्टोरेंट and the retrofitted support and storage spaces. The main concept was determined by the two critical intersections with the original building. First with the rotunda at the existing circulation core and second with the monitor building along its east wall. It provides the balcony views and access to the rotunda from the three new two-story galleries and one single story gallery. There is a transparent glass wall connecting the monitor building and the addition one, and it reveals the original facade from both the outside in and inside out. With the large rotunda as well as with the new addition also, the pavilions are now integrated functionally and spatially. So, and the new fifth floor roof sculpture terrace is there. The large rotunda roof terrace and the renovated public ramp, they reveals the original building in a new extended and comprehensive perspective. So here in the images we can see the restored rotunda skylight, and in the second image sculpture terrace is showing the intersection of large rotunda and the addition one. Now the entire original structure is devoted to exhibition space, and each ramp cycle affords the option of entry or views to the new galleries. Within the rotunda, there are numerous technical refinements which have corrected the omissions in the original construction and in this way brought the building up to the current museum standards. By reglazing the central lantern, opening the clear stories between the turns of the spiral wall, and by restoring the scalloped flat clear story at the perimeter of the ground floor exhibition space, he has recaptured the sensitivity to light evident in Wright's original design. Here in the first image, we can see here the north facade showing the infill glass wall, and then in the other image the renovated seventh level ramp in large rotunda zone. Here this is the image from the second floor gallery of infill glass curtain wall. From inside it is. These drawings are showing the vertical details in first image through the rotunda and the second one through the addition one. Now we will discuss about the architect Zorneder, another architect of New York Five Group. He was also an American architect and well known for his artwork, published writing and the experiences as an educator. Hedrick spent most of his life living and working in the New York, although not many of his designs were ever built, and he has a body of published work that was preoccupied with the obscure objects and the shapes that were often beyond the buildability. Haddock's interest in abstract shapes was furthered by the organization, representation, and the reciprocity in architecture. He has been affiliated with the several architectural schools of practice, including the New York Five, which disseminated from a Museum of Modern Art MOMA publication that included the works of five architects. He was the dean of Cooper Union School of Art and Architecture, and during his time at the Cooper Union, Haddock transformed the architectural education, practice, and critical thought through the cooperation of many influential professors of the time. The changes that were instigated have been compared to impact that the Mies van der Rohe had at the Illinois Institute of Technology. Now, talking about the design process of architect John Haddock, his early works and the subsequent curriculum stemmed from the exercises that explored cubes, grids, and frames sliced with the diagonal containers often set against a curving wall. And from here, he moved towards the experiments with flat planes coupled with the curving masses in bright color combinations, as here we can see in the given image of Wall House 2, one of his projects. In 1967, he was awarded a grant from the Graham Foundation to aid his research. In modernist space making, these exercises drew heavy influence from the F.L. Wright and Mies van der Rohe's design, and they gave way to explorations in freehand figure objects. Influenced by the mythology and spirituality, clearly expressing the nature of his poetry, the relationship between the shapes and the objects produced by Haddock in context to their surroundings has been a controversial subject. Similarly, as raising the questions to the early residential work by Peter Eisenman, as we discussed in the previous slides, while discussing the Peter Eisenman, realized projects of John Haddock began to be built in 1980s, with a small concentration in Berlin, including the Haddock Tower, House for the Two Brothers, and Gatehouse. So this Wall House 2, it was an early and important project of architect John Haddock. We will discuss this in detail. This residence was initially designed by John Haddock in 1973 for his fellow faculty member at the Irwin School of Architecture at Copper Union in New York, and it was to be constructed in Ridgefield in Connecticut. But because of the high estimated cost of construction in the wooded area, this project was put on hold, and passing from the potential client to potential client, it was always being dropped before the beginning of construction due to the lack of funding, until a development company in Groningen, they took special interest in this project and decided to fund the construction. It was not until the unexpected death of John Haddock that construction on the house began. The concept behind the design of this house was like the work and living, they are different functions, and as such they should be separated architecturally. And this thing was expressed through the concrete wall element that is separating the working and the living areas of the house. As we can see here in the images, there is a gray color standing wall in between. So the design of Wall House 2 is like, it is a fusion of surrealist sculpture, cubist paintings, and architecture, and which is reflecting the John Haddock's identity as an artist, poet, educator, and architect. So the inspiration for his work often came from the Le Corbusier and Mies van der Rohe, where he learned to focus on the more flat dimensions of architectural form as well as the focus on pure volumes. He organized around a central axis of horizontal and vertical plane, a three-dimensionality, and it allows for experiencing the spaces. Accompanying these, a two-dimensional plane disconnects, but at the same time, it groups the functional spaces which appear separate from one another while emphasizing the poetic nature of the residence. The use of light colors in this design encourages the visual distinction between the volumes created, which are accessible by means of a spiral staircase that sits at the backside of the wall, and dividing the space, the wall appears to be freestanding through the careful design of header, as it is supported with a glass connection to the volumes, as here we can see in the images. So the wall painted in gray color is actually representing the neutral condition, and the wall represents the same condition as the time of the hypotenuse in the diamond houses. It is the greatest moment of repose and at the same time the greatest tension. So it is a moment of passage. The wall heightens that sense of passage, and by the same token, its thickness heightens the sense of it being just a momentary condition. While entering the house, the visitor encounters a flight of stairs which leads to the study, kitchen and dining room, and these all spaces are biomorphically shaped with much character. The first floor is having a bedroom and the top floor holds the living area. Each volume appears to be cantilevered, as we can see here in the photographs, but in actuality the floating masses are supported by a grid of columns, and this thing adds to the dramatic design of this wall house too, as the large wall becomes symbolic, non-structural, which is separating the two categories of spaces. In the recently constructed wall house too, the interesting aspect is its accessibility, as the owners have divided the residence into public, semi-public and the private quarters, so that the architecture may be experienced and interpreted by all. The artists are invited to participate in the residence program, in which they reside in the building to research the poetics of space in architecture. If we talk about the materials in this structure, a reinforced concrete structure was used for the dividing wall and the columns. The corridor was built with steel frame, wooden walls and a stucco exterior. The wall that due to the Haddock's careful design seems to be independent joins the volumes through a glass connection. So here these are the drawings. Below we can see the plan from different two levels, and the above image is showing the vertical details of the building at different levels, and we can see the staircase and the corridor, the living spaces and the working areas. The another work of architect John Redek which we are going to discuss here is the Rehberg Tower in Berlin. This Rehberg Tower was part of the 1987 IBA program, and the German program continues to support innovative architecture and design through built and unbuilt projects. In the year 1987, this IBA invited noted architects and designers to envision the new low and middle income housing for the West Berlin, and the architect John Redek's project is composed of a 14-story tower with two separate 5-story wings. The neutral colored tower and the wings, they feature green geometric shapes attached to the facades, and These extrusions, they serve as the balconies and sunsets for the low income housing units. For this tower, the proposed refurbishment by the owners had included changes such as removal of the sunsets and expanding the balconies. But the negative attention produced by the architecture community halted the changes and encouraged a reconsideration of the importance of the building. And today, this rework tower is protected by the government with a clause stating that the plans to alter it must be considered by the city's building department and the appropriate historians, as well as all of the 1987 IBA buildings. Now we will discuss about the architect Richard Meyer. He is also an American architect and he was born in October 1934. He is also the second cousin of architect Peter Eisenman, which we discussed earlier. Architect Richard Meyer worked for Skidmore, Owings and Merrill, and then he worked for 3 years for Marshall Brewer, starting his own practice in New York in 1963. He was identified as one of the New York Five in 1972. Architect Richard Meyer and his partners are having offices in New York, Los Angeles, with the current projects ranging from the China to Paris and Hamburg. The works of architect Richard Meyer are characterized by the dynamic use of light, and if we talk about the color, when faced with the aura of Richard Meyer, one immediately notices the color, and in his buildings, white is the most predominant color used. Talking about the place, the third theme of Richard Meyer is place, or maybe better, the things that make a space a place. And what makes a space a place? Activity. Actually, the activity makes a space a place. Without activity, it is not a place. He maintained a specific, unalterable attitude towards his design. Meyer has ignored the fashion trends of modern architecture and he maintained his own design philosophy. He usually designs white Neo Corbusian forms with enameled panels and glass. His structure usually play with the linear relationships of ramps and handrails. All have a similar look. Richard Meyer manages to generate endless variations on a singular theme. So here is the list of important buildings designed by architect Richard Meyer. West Beth Artist Community in 1970, Meyer House in New Jersey, designed in 1965, Smith House in Connecticut in 1965, Douglas House in Michigan, designed in 1973, Barcelona Museum of Contemporary Art in Spain, designed in 1995, City Hall and Central Library, designed in 1995, Getty Center in California, designed in 1997, and the Meyer Tower in 2008 to present, International Coffee Plaza in Hamburg, Germany, was designed in 2010, and Vitrum Apartments in Colombia, designed in 2013. Now we will discuss his one of the project, Smith House, in detail, and we'll try to understand his design approach. This house is a part of series of single family homes, rationalists, that mark a first step in the work of Meyer when it was part of the group The Five Architects. So the compact prismatic shape of the house expresses a certain attitude toward the place, and besides being A refuse is also an object reflecting and refracting the surrounding natural scene. This house is rooted in the strong tradition of family houses in New England and self-sufficient units. It was designed in such a way that it is located on a wooden hillside, and house is inserted into the natural landscape conceived as an artificial object overlooking Long Island Sound. So, following the indications of where the approach, entry, access, and the views are organized to explore the contours of the site, offers an unusual perspective of landscape and the waterways. So, it was designed on such conditions. As this house is located on a hillside, so the concept to design this was like a prismatic volume, white prismatic volume that emerges among the trees, creating a stark visual contrast. And starting operation in the style of rationalism, Corbusierano, some critics have characterized as a mannerist cue main volume. Meyer is carving his work based operations of addition and subtraction. So, based on the method of addition and subtraction, the backside is treated as a closed facade with small openings, whereas the front face is an open facade with large glass panels, and they are offering the sweeping views of the horizon. And this we will see in the photographs also. Spatial organization of the house revolves around a programmed between public and private area separate. And if we talk about the private area, the private part of the house is in the area looking to the forest and the road, whereas the main entrance to the house is located, it is the south facade with a series of closed cellular spaces. These private areas are organized through three levels behind an opaque facade by some windows and intermittently placed. If we talk about the public spaces where the family gathers and shares his social life, they are in the back of the house overlooking the water. In this sector, the box is broken down into a large glazed and a laterally staggered front that opens to the downward slope of the hillside. This scalability is produced by the successive social lag of three plants, phase shift, which causes the appearance of double and triple heights, and it is contributing to the dramatization of the interior space of the house. From the outside, the ground floor and the upper floors, they appear as a solid slab, struts firmly attached to the cell white crystal. The curved staircase that is descending from the first floor to the natural terrain, cubic annex small deposit, and the access ramp to the house, and the home box with duct adding volumes, they are qualifying the central volume while anchor it to the ground. So here in the photographs we can see the backside area looking to the water outside, and the curved staircase we can see here. Talking about the circulation system, it guides the movement through the house, extends far beyond the limits of the building itself. Within the Smith house, it joins the horizontal movement of the cells, deprived areas, and also links them to the public areas. The vertical movements occurs in the stairwell located within the area enclosed room, and the largest circulation pattern and the activity related discrete spatial units inside. The angle of the garage toward the path leading to the main facade and the curved wall on one side helps to draw the open area of the house. SS is located on the upstream side of the house and the main view is towards the downstream portion of the land. इसके स्ट्रक्चर को देख करके कई बार ऐसा लगता है कि ये बना है कंक्रीट में, बट व्हेन इन फैक्ट इट इज़ मेड ऑफ वुड. वंस इट क्रॉस द साउथ फसाड, वुडन स्ट्रक्चर दैट हाउसेज द प्राइवेट एरियाज ऑफ द हाउस एंड यूटिलिटी अपीयर्स. द लिंक बिटवीन द टू कॉन्ट्रास्टिंग स्पेसिस दैट फॉर्म द हाउस द प्राइवेट एंड द पब्लिक एक्सप्रेस थ्रू टू स्ट्रक्चरल सिस्टम्स. एज इन द पब्लिक स्पेसिस द स्ट्रक्चर कंसिस्ट ऑफ राउंड स्टील कॉलम्स स्टैंडिंग फ्री सपोर्टिंग द बीम्स एंड द रूफ इंडिपेंडेंट एलिमेंट्स दैट डिस्क्राइब द पैटर्न. एंड इन द प्राइवेट और क्लोज्ड साइड ऑफ द हाउस वॉल्स आर टिम्बर्ड एंड एक्सटर्नल कंस्ट्रक्शन मटीरियल्स वर्टिकल पैनलिंग एंड ग्लास दे ऑल्सो सर्व टू एक्सप्रेस द कॉन्ट्रास्ट बिटवीन द ओपन एंड द क्लोज स्पेसिस. So this abrupt juxtaposition of solid and void, incomplete without the other, and expressing an apparent tension and a dialectic between the two areas. Here in the photograph, we can see that the glass wall suspended between the brick fireplace and the structural pillars. So it creates a subtle tension that leads to who occupies a part of the outer life. The railings of the upper and the lower levels with a setback from the glass accentuates this feeling. The fireplace located opposite the entrance, it is pulled outward by a strict framework of uprights. The main materials used in the construction of this house are wood and glass with the structural steel columns. In the conservatory area like fireplace, large glass walls are used which allow the reflections and light changes according to the whims of the nature. The natural and artificial exist as independent elementary experiences in this house, though impossible to separate one from the other. Now we will see the drawings of this Smith house. So this is the lower level plan. We can see here the staircase, the fireplace and the areas created, and the second one is the middle level plan. Here this is the upper level plan and the southeast side elevation. In the elevation we can see what we were discussing. Here there is the fireplace, brick fireplace in the elevation, and the glass curtain walls can be seen. This is the northwest elevation of the building and the vertical sections showing the vertical details at various levels in the building. Now we will discuss the Getty Center, another project of architect Richard Meyer, in detail. The Getty Center, which was completed in 1997, it occupies a narrow hilly stretch high above the San Diego Freeway in Los Angeles, California, and jutting southward from the Santa Monica Mountains. The museum is an acropolis-like structure, affords spectacular views over the city and the mountains and the ocean. This museum is having the permanent collection, contains Greek and Roman antiquities of 18th century French furniture and the European paintings. So this is the collection. And it is visited by more than 1.8 million people per year. Richard Meyer designed in such a way that he brings the seven components of the Getty Trust into a coherent unity maintaining their individual identities. The layout establishes a dialogue between angle of intersection and a number of curvilinear forms that are largely derived from the contours of the site inflected by the freeway. So the metropolitan grid and the natural topography overall parts relate to both the city of Los Angeles as well as the Santa Monica Mountains. This center covers almost 100,000 square feet of area, and it is organized along the two ridges in the topography of 110-acre parcel. This museum acts as the centerpiece and the main entrance to the center. I mean the entire Getty Center. The entrance lobby has a sunlit circular foyer, you can see here in the first image, and provides views through the courtyard to gallery structures and arrayed in a continuous sequence. Throughout the museum, there is a layering in between paintings illuminated by skylights on the top floor and artworks which must be shielded from ultraviolet light on the lower levels. So the smaller pavilion buildings are connecting by the gardens. They break down the scale of the museum experience, allowing for pauses and encouraging the interplay between the interior and the exterior spaces. Each pavilion cluster has its own atrium with an adjacent stairway and elevator linking the sculpture, drawing, manuscript and the photography galleries on the first floor to the paintings and galleries above. West of the Getty Trust offices, there is a 450-seat auditorium and the Art History Information Program that terminate the east elevation. The Getty Conservation Institute, the Getty Center for Education, Getty Grant Program, they take advantage of the climate through the use of lodges, pergolas and the full height glazing at the external perimeter. Along the more secluded western ridge, there is the Getty Research Institute for the History of Art and Humanities, and that completes the complex. This Getty Center was the first building to be LEED certified after the standard was established by US Green Building Council in 1998. So it is a reflection of Richard Meyer and partners design philosophy that innately considered sustainable elements like the natural light is used, circulation and energy saving technologies and the materials. Now I want to show you the drawings of this Getty Center. What we discussed, it will be more clear after seeing the drawings. So this is the overall site plan. Then the 3D view showing the all seven components of Getty Center. And this is the layout plan at entry level. This is the upper level plan showing various spaces. Here these are the elevations. The upper one is the north elevation and the lower one is the east elevation. Thank you.